Labor Day weekend. For some of us, the end of the CNE and the beginning of pumpkin spice. It's a personal day, a holiday for some, and a community day as many will march. Kids are going back to school, but for some of us, it really is hard to let go. Can we love our way through difficult times into a new season, not just autumn, but a new way of being together? Is it getting better? Or do you feel the same? Is it easier? Or in this day and age, are you getting ready to blame? Welcome to worship at Jubilee, where we wonder the same things that you wonder, where we listen as best we can to hear one love, a love we can share as we carry each other. This is faith. This is Jubilee. We're very glad that you're here.
Is it getting better? Or do you feel the same? Will it make it easier on you? You've got someone to blame. You say, one love, one life, it's one need in the night, one love, get to share it, leaves you darling, if you don't care for it.
Did I disappoint you? Or leave a bad taste in your mouth? You act like you never had love, and you want me to go without. Well, it's too late tonight to drag the past out. Each other, carry each other. For forgiveness, have you come to raise the dead? Have you come here to play Jesus to the lepers in your head?
Well, did I more than a lot?
You gave me nothing, now it's all.
One love, one love.
good news? Well, from our refugee committee, the Amiar family have arrived safely in Canada. They are currently with extended family and figuring out what happens next. But whatever that may be, it is hopeful and promising. We'll have pictures in upcoming weeks, but for now, let it be enough that they are here. For more good news, well, we turn to the Jubilee Bee, who has been to Newfoundland with Kai. Spent some time checking out antique cars and fabulous views with Marlene at Casa Loma. Yeah, JB sure gets around and has a lot of fun too. And that is really good news.
I want to say to Grandma Goodtop for the bees.
Thank you.
Do you love them?
Yes.
Good.
My good luck charm. I'm bringing them to the OVA so we win. Perfect.
Welcome to the Jubilee community and our digital Sunday service. The themes and the scripture are very similar to the Jubilee in-person service, but this service is created specifically for you, our digital community. You are unique, and together with the in-person community, we are all Jubilee. Whether you connect digitally all the time or some of the time, join us in person often, once in a while, or never, you belong. You help to determine who we are and how we do things. You are the people who share what we do with friends, the things that we put on TikTok and Instagram, Facebook and YouTube. Here's one that took off recently.
When I try to jam this breastplate, this relationship with God around my life, fit around the clothes that I'm already wearing, it just doesn't work. In relationship with God, I need to simply, well, be me, just me. Get right with God, then assume all the other parts of my identity.
Thank you for helping to shape us as you share what we do, contribute your thoughts and ideas, and together we live into this relationship that we have with each other and with God. By the way, you can stick around for or fast forward to the end of our service for announcements, opportunities to get involved, and ways that you can offer financial support to this ministry that we share. Some people wonder why we have to do this. You know, the acknowledgments as we begin to worship together. And although it's less than 4 minutes, we wonder if maybe we could use the time better. Now, maybe we could. But in less than 4 minutes, we get to say to someone who wonders if their truest self belongs in a faith community, yes, it does. Yes, you do. We get to speak against those voices that diminish, separate, and disparage those who identify as lesbian, gay, bi, trans, queer, two-spirited, non-binary, gender fluid, or simply those not prepared to be defined by others. And we get to affirm that they are loved by God and that they are part of our family. And some, upon hearing those words for the first time, they weep. Even when they hear it for the fifth time. I know. I've seen it. In less than 4 minutes, we remind ourselves that we are on land that has spirit. It nurtures us, and we are in relationship with this land and the people who have been on this land. We take a few seconds to acknowledge those who have cared for the land for 15,000 years, who welcomed settlers and later made room for refugees and others who came here not by choice. We take a moment, just a moment, to acknowledge the damage done by the colonial attitudes that ignored the spirituality of the indigenous inhabitants of this land, including the Anishinaabe, the Haudenosaunee, the Chippewa, the Mississaugas of the Credit, and many others. We confess to broken treaties and systemic inhumanity and racism so that we can commit ourselves to a better future, where we not only respect indigenous cultures, but also learn from them and allow them and their medicine, their wisdom, to shape our lives and ways of being. These are the words that give our injured and wary Indigenous siblings some hope. And they remind us that we have work to do every day as we try to decolonize our thinking and open ourselves up to the glorious diversity of God and God's love. In less than 4 minutes, we commit ourselves to seeing the world as God sees it. Hurting, but redeemable. Fractured, but healing. In less than 4 minutes, we are reminded of our responsibility as people of faith. To see and to love our neighbors. To love and to share God's love. In less than 4 minutes, we are reminded how diverse and amazing is this family of which we are all part. In less than 4 minutes, we are reminded how we can live as people of faith all day, every day. As I come to light the Christ candle, I share with you this thank you note from Good Fish United Church, an Indigenous church in northern Alberta, who had hymn books for everyone for the very first time last week, thanks to Jubilee sending 60 more Voices and Voices United hymn books to them, something that we could do with the bounty of resources from Forest Grove United Church. Forest Grove United Church and Jubilee United Church folks, now all together thanks to amalgamation. Together we've done our best to carry on the love and the legacy of Forest Grove in the lives of other congregations. Sending nativity play costumes to Parkwoods United Church. Banners and liturgical accessories to Asbury and West United Church. And sanctuary chairs and other necessary items to Aurora United Church, who are on schedule to reopen next summer after being devastated by fire 10 years ago. When we share our love and our resources, the light of Christ burns very brightly as we support the ministries of other communities of faith. The light of Christ meant to be shared. Gospel, chapter 7, verses 1 through 23, from Walking the Good Road, a translation of the Gospels by Indigenous scholars and elders from across Turtle Island. As I read the text, you will discover that Village of Peace is Jerusalem. Creator Sets Free is Jesus. The Separated Ones are the Pharisees. Creator Will Help Us is the prophet Isaiah. Drawn from the water is Moses. The Separated Ones and some of the scroll keepers had come from the Village of Peace. Like hungry wolves, they gathered round Creator Sets Free. They were looking for ways to accuse him and make him look bad in the eyes of the people, for they were jealous of his reputation. They noticed that some of his followers had not ceremonially washed their hands before eating the food. The separated ones and many of the tribal people will not eat until they ceremonially wash their hands following the traditions of the elders. They will not eat the food offered at the trading posts unless it is first purified by washing. They also follow many other traditions, like the washing of drinking cups, bowls, and even the benches they sit on. So the separated ones and the scroll keepers asked him, "Why do your followers not walk in the traditions of the elders and ceremonially wash their hands before eating?" "Your false faces do not fool me," he answered back. "The prophet Creator will help us was talking about you when he said in the sacred teachings, 'These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far away from me. Their prayers are empty words and their ceremonies are for show. Their teachings are nothing but rules made up by weak human beings.'" He paused to let these words sink into their ears. Then he said to them, "You ignore the instructions given by the Great Spirit and use your traditions to make yourselves look good to others. You are as sly as coyote in the way you set aside Creator's instructions and replace them with your traditions. The lawgiver drawn from the water said, 'Give honor to your father and mother, and the ones who dishonor them should be put to death.' But your tradition says, if someone says to their father or mother, 'I have given to the Great Spirit the things that were meant to honor and take care of you,' then they no longer have to honor and care for their parents. This is only one of the many ways you use your traditions to do away with the words of the Great Spirit. Creator sets free, then gathered the people around him and said, 'Listen with your hearts and understand what I tell you. There is nothing you can take into your mouth that will make you impure. It is what comes out of your mouth that makes you impure.' Later, when they entered the house away from the crowds, the ones who walked the road with him asked the meaning of this wise saying. 'Why do you not understand?' he answered them. 'When food enters the mouth, it goes into the stomach, not the heart, and then out of the body.' In saying this, Creator sets free, declared that nothing you eat can make you impure. It is what comes out of a person from within that makes one impure. From people's bad hearts and broken ways come worthless plans, sexual impurity, stealing, killing, unfaithfulness in marriage, greed, evil doings, forked tongues, uncontrolled desires, selfish ways, speaking evil of others, boastful talk, and foolish ways. It is things like this that make a person impure, not failing to wash one's hands."
The Song of Solomon, chapter 2, verses 8 through 13.
The voice of my beloved. Look, he comes leaping upon the mountains, bounding over the hills. My beloved is like a gazelle or a young stag. Look, there he stands behind our wall, gazing in at the windows, looking through the lattice. My beloved speaks and says to me, "Arise, my love, my fair one, and come away. For now the winter is past, the rain is over and gone. The flowers appear on the earth, the time of singing has come, and the voice of the turtle dove is heard in our land. The fig tree puts forth its figs, and the vines are in blossom. They give forth fragrance. Ah, arise, my love, my fair one, and come away."
Times are changing,
I've lost my way. While the words of ancient poets fall like dust upon my shoes, greed has robbed me of my vision, turned my heart from higher truths. So take our hands and draw us near. Hold us close and calm our fears. When there's darkness all around, take our hearts to higher ground. I have walked too long in darkness. I have walked too long alone, blindly clutching fists of diamonds that I thought were only stone. I would trade the wealth of ages for a warmer hand to hold. Though the path of life is narrow, but it leads to streets of gold. So take our hands and draw us near. Hold us close and come. Darkness all around, take our hearts to higher ground. In this world we move through shadows, never sure of what we see. While the truth abides between us, come and share the truth with me. So take our hands and draw us near. Hold us close and calm our fears. When there's darkness, hearts to higher ground. When there's darkness all around, take our hearts to higher.
Let us pray. Loving God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts, stony hearts, romantic hearts, broken hearts, open hearts, bleeding hearts, healing hearts, may the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your eyes. And God, may I never lightly presume to preach your word. And may we never lightly presume to hear your word, for in your word is abundant life. Amen. Oh my, I'm at a loss today. Included in the prescribed readings for the day. You know, there's this three-year cycle, and most of us sort of follow the readings that we get every Sunday. Boom, there's your choice. Well, today we've got something from the Song of Songs, also called the Song of Solomon. And basically, it's a love letter that Solomon apparently has written. Now, I could skip it. I could do that. I could just focus on the other text. It's not like you have to read all four all the time. Goodness knows I don't. But it just sort of really bugs me that we've got this love letter jammed into our very serious and important scripture. You know? And so I can't let it go. The voice of my beloved. Look. He comes leaping upon the mountains, bounding over the hills. Oh, my. My beloved is like a gazelle or a young stag. Look, there he stands behind our wall, gazing in at the windows, looking through the lattice. Rather cheeky. My beloved speaks and says to me, "Arise, my love, my fair one, and come away." Please. Oh, man. It's a Norah Jones B-side. It's imagine talking about faith like a romance. I mean, it's silly. You know it's silly. I know it's silly. Faith is a very specific series of instructions and achievements, rituals and practices by which we make ourselves fit for a heaven that we do not deserve. And if, by the way, you can do all of that in Latin, so much the better. But apparently Solomon, or his writer, thinks that we can talk about faith like a romance, which is just silly. And when I say silly, I say so in the company of Martin Luther, who recognized the Song of Solomon only as political allegory. You probably also would have thought that Bridgerton was about architecture. But never mind, it's not meant to be taken at face value. But Luther and I don't always agree. So maybe there's something in this. I don't know. What else am I going to preach about? Love letters as scripture? Well, all right. Let's imagine what that might be like. Dear Faith, I really, really, really like you. Ever since I met you, I've liked you. I'm not even sure why. I just know that when I'm with you, I feel good. I like walking with you. I really like it when you come to my house and say, "Come away with me." And we play and we do stuff together until the streetlights come on and we have to go home. I hope that we'll always be friends. Signed, me. You know, I remember when I was 5, there was this girl named Cindy, lived down the street on the other side of Oriole Park Public School, and I was smitten. Every day I would walk down to her house, and then we would walk back to school holding hands. And then we would hold hands as I walked her home at the end of school. Older kids, they would tease us, but somehow, I don't know, I was just happy holding her hand and walking her home. I really don't know why. I was just happy. I was going to Sunday school then. My parents took me. And I do remember that I really liked the stories and I liked making pictures and things. I liked that Jesus loved me. I mean, who wouldn't like that, right? Didn't know why he did, but it was good to know that God thought that I was lovable. Yeah. Dear Faith, you make me mad. I thought that you were my friend. But I guess you want to be friends with other people. So fine, we're not friends anymore. Go away from me and see if I care. Signed, me. One of my mother's favorite stories is about the day that I came home from kindergarten and I declared, "I don't care what they say about getting an education for a better job, I quit." My teacher, Miss McMurtry, had told the class that she was engaged and was getting married. And I felt betrayed. I mean, it may not have been realistic for her to wait for me to come to an appropriate age, but I somehow felt that I should have been consulted in her decision. And I have met people who have abandoned their faith or stormed away angry when it no longer fits into their own political or social viewpoint, when it doesn't match their plans or agendas. When faith is all about me, oh man, it's great. But when it becomes about someone else, or seems to have a preferential option for someone other than me, or challenges the way that I think or do things, well, then you know what? No, I have no more time. I have no more time to waste on these naive communists. Enough of that. Dear Faith, I don't know if you know this, but I really like you. I like the way that you talk and how you ask hard questions. I was glad that you challenged me when I was talking about people who don't really deserve our concern. I think I've even changed my mind because of our conversation. There are lots of great people around, but somehow I just notice you the most. The way that you dress, the way that you talk, the way that your eyes smile when you laugh. I enjoy our talks and how we never run out of things to say to each other. I don't know if you feel the same way, but it would be really nice if you would come away with me to dinner or a movie sometime. And if you don't want to, I get it, but I hope that you will. Me. I think sometimes, if we're fortunate, we have the opportunity to re-engage with faith. You know, we read a book or we hear a song, we meet someone who has it, you know, this gift of faith, and then we begin a conversation with them. We run into someone who isn't keeping their faith a secret, but speaks kindly and openly about what they believe, and they seem happy, satisfied with life, and we want to have what they have, you know, a faith, an engagement with God that's dynamic and real and fulfilling. We let go of the faith of our childhood and discover a rich depth of experience and meaning. Dear Faith, I know you want me to come away with you. And I know that we've been together for a long time now, and you're so special to me. I just don't know if I'm ready. I just got this job and my career is beginning. I want to commit to you, but there's so much going on in my life. I feel like I just can't settle down right now. Hey, there isn't anyone else. It's just life. If you can be patient with me, I really think that it will work out eventually. Signed, me. And as great as faith can be, there are the pressures of our world. You know, to succeed and provide and achieve. We know what we need to do to get that promotion and or build that business or buy that house, and we know that success will only come with extra effort. I mean, a lot of commitment. And so we put in the long hours and we make sacrifices. And you know, as we're making sacrifices, one of the easiest things to let go of, well, is the time that we engage with God. Sunday mornings, prayer time, retreats, the time it takes to reconsider an action in light of God's love. I don't have time to reconsider. I'm in a hurry here. All of these things, we say to ourselves, well, we'll pick those up later. We tell ourselves that we just don't have time for them right now, later. Dear Faith, I can't believe what a fool I've been. I've been building this life and I hardly noticed that I wasn't making any room for you in it. When you left last night, I realized how empty everything feels. I don't care about the house or the car or the money or the vacations or any of that if you're not going to share it with me. I know that I drove you away, but please, please come back. Please come away with me just one more time and I'll show you that I've changed. Please. Me. And suddenly, it's gone. Faith is no longer a part of what we do or who we are. I mean, we call ourselves faithful. We can identify in a census. You know, we have a church that we consider ours. But in our hearts, we know that it's gone. Dear Faith, thank you. I never knew that I could feel so alone. After the funeral, I just felt completely alone in the universe. There was no one to talk to lean on. Nobody could understand how I was feeling and just kept offering terrible advice. They made me so angry. But then you showed up. Then I hadn't seen you in so long. And you just held my hand and didn't say anything except, come away with me. And even though we didn't move, I began to leave my pain behind. You made me realize that I'm not alone. Thank you. I know that it sounds dramatic, but thank you for saving me. When we sat and softly sang those songs that we used to know, I felt at home. I felt at home for the first time in almost forever. I felt whole for the first time since you left. I've always known that I love you. I just never knew how much I needed you. And I don't know if we get together or get to be together in the days ahead. But I want to thank you so much for today and the best yesterdays. Gratefully, me. I suspect you've been there. I've been there. At times of death or tragedy, there's nothing to do or say, and you just sit there with that person who needs you. And maybe you sing old hymns under your breath together. You know that their world is crumbling and that you can't stop it, but you can be present with them. And from time to time, more often than you might imagine, they begin to feel the presence of God because of you. They recognize that supportive embrace of faith. And it isn't always a tragic circumstance, but it often is. We discover that faith is more than something that we do to secure a good afterlife. We realize that it has a very present value in our lives here and now. It has a call to which we want to respond and an assurance that we're not alone. Dear Faith, on our 10th anniversary, I want you to come away with me so that we can celebrate. Away from the usual distractions of life, so that we can experience the joy of being together in our bodies, in our minds, our imaginations, and our feelings. Powerful intimacy that has made me my best person, a complete person. I want to celebrate how we're both different because we're together, how I've changed and you've changed, and we've created together this unique life. Arise and come away with me, my love. Lovingly, me. In the fullness of our faith, in the challenge and in the comfort, in the engagement of our complete selves, in our bodies as we engage in the work of faith, experience the taste of bread and wine, body and blood, in our listening to one another's stories, listening in the silence, being vulnerable in prayer and in witness, as our imaginations add layers and nuances to stories that we've been told for millennia. As we think critically about the stories and traditions that surround us and apply them to the life that we live now, we create something together that is deeply intimate, deeply holy, and we cannot be the same. Neither is the faith or God unchanged in the engagement with us, because this faith is a relationship, and a relationship we change with and because of each other. You, me, God. Dear Faith, I saw a man on the beach, and he was whistling as he carried a chair a few yards down the beach. He was not a young man. Neither was the woman who was sitting on a second chair. She was frail and looking out at the ocean. And then he went back to where she was sitting, helped her stand, and walked a few yards to the chair that he had just placed in the sand. And as she sat and rested, gazing out at the ocean, he went back and picked up the abandoned chair and carried it on just a few yards past where she was sitting, placed it down, and went back to his loved and loving partner, helping her up and down the beach to the next chair. And they repeated this process all along the beach and back to their car. In that moment, I saw not only love, real love, but I saw us meeting each other where we are, sharing the joy of the moment instead of mourning the passage of time. I recognize the times that you have met me in my weakness and still welcomed my gifts and my love. How you've been with me always, always inviting me to not only love you, but in my love for you, to love the world. I have learned to see the world through your eyes as well as mine. To experience the stranger with your heart as well as mine. And I realize now that I can afford to love the world even when I feel inadequate to the task. Because I'm not alone. I have you. Moving my chair along the beach, inviting me each time to arise and come away with me to the next chair, the next opportunity, the next moment. Thank you, my love. Me. Faith comes to us in many a guise. It's not really a gift, a thing you can obtain and contain. It's a relationship that challenges and embraces and struggles and grows. It changes as we change. It is deeply intimate and powerfully personal. And it requires many letters, many songs. Or maybe Luther's right, and this is all silly. I'll let you decide. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Loving God, in this moment and in private moments too numerous to numerate, we pray. We pray our heads, and we pray our hearts. We pray our lives. We share and we listen, God. We arise and come away with you in these moments. God, we give thanks for the joys of summer and the promises of fall. We are grateful for friends and family who truly know us as we are. Not for who we might be and not for who we have been, but those who see us right now and love us as we are. We give thanks for creation that nurtures, inspires, calms, and excites us every day. We pray for children going back to school, back to the routine. We pray for those going to college, university, a new school for the first time. The excitement and the fear, the wonder and the worry. Let each of us know that there is a place for us in that which is new. A need for our gifts.
a place of sanctuary when we need to get away, and an adventure ready to unfold. Remind us that we are not alone, and we never, ever need to fear change. We pray, God, for parents, some relieved as children head off, and some distraught, watching their child grow up, missing the time together, worried about everything that might go wrong, and wanting to make life perfect for their child. God, remind them, remind us, that nobody learns without some conflict, some adjustment, and that we are stronger than we know, stronger than our parents know, and we are not alone. God, we pray for teachers, ready to engage and help to shape young lives, willing students, and those not quite ready to be willing yet. Remind them that theirs is a sacred task, and that our communities are forever indebted to them for their knowledge, skill, labor, and love. And God, for those of us not going back to school or even back to routine, remind us that whatever challenges may be ahead, we too are stronger than we think. When peace seems impossible and justice a joke, encourage us to risk, to hope, and to act, knowing that you are with us and that love is the ultimate and only true power. So God, let us work for peace as we feed on hope. Let us dare to love as we stand with Jesus. Let us be at peace as we live in the Spirit. And let us be at home as we walk with you. We pray in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray with these words.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Arise, beloved, and go away. Go away and out into the world with God, the Creator. Arise, go away with Jesus, who walks with us down the beach, a few steps at a time. Arise and go away into the world to love the world, knowing that the Holy Spirit absolutely surrounds and fills you, makes loving the world not only possible, but delightful. Arise, go away. And until we gather again, amen. Thank you.
never close your eyes anymore when I kiss your lips. And there's no tenderness like before in your fingertips. You're trying hard not to show it,
baby.
But baby, baby, I know it. And you lost that love and feeling. Whoa, that love and feeling. And you've lost that love and feeling. Now it's gone, gone, gone. Whoa, whoa, whoa.
Now there's no welcome look in your eyes when I reach for you. Now you're starting to criticize little things I do. It makes me just feel like crying,
baby.
'Cause baby, something beautiful's dying.
And you lost that love and feeling.
And whoa, that love. Gone, gone, gone. Oh, oh, oh. Baby, baby, I get down on my knees for you.
If you would only love me like you used to do. We had a love, a love, a love you don't find every day. So don't let it slip away. Bring back that love and feeling. And whoa, that love and feeling. And bring back that love and feeling. Now it's gone, gone, gone. And I can't go on. Whoa, whoa, whoa.
So now that we've worshipped and wondered, let's see how we might be in love with the world. As mentioned during the good news, the Amayar family have arrived safely and are currently with extended family. We have housing options that we are exploring, and we really appreciate all the support that you've been giving. We look forward to sharing updates in the coming weeks, but for now, please accept our gratitude for all of your love for this family, who are now safe here in Canada. We have a change of date and a correction of a typo from last week. On Wednesday, September the 4th, this Wednesday at 7 p.m. in Toronto, that'd be 4 p.m. in BC, 5 p.m. in Calgary and Winnipeg, 8 p.m. in Halifax, I'm hosting a digital summit on Zoom. Just a chance to talk about Jubilee's digital ministry. What are we getting right? What are we getting wrong? What can we do that we're not doing? And what's next? We see the digital ministry as a unique community that is part of Jubilee, not a feeder group to get people to join Jubilee in person. The digital community provides financial support to Jubilee, provides feedback directly to me, asks things of our ministry staff that indicate a sense of connection and trust. So what's next? Or is this enough? I don't really know, but I'd love to hear from you, and maybe together we'll figure it out. This Wednesday at 7 p.m. Toronto time, join me and let's keep building something special. The link is on the Jubilee website. Our monthly digital chat is also moving in September, by popular request, to Sunday, September the 15th. We're moving to the third Sunday of the month so that some more of our friends might be able to join us. For six Thursdays in October and November, October 10th through November 14th, in person at Jubilee, we will be offering When Life Changes, a group that will learn how to move through grief with greater awareness, hope, and health. This grief education and support program is designed for those who are dealing with the death of a loved one. Taking a faith-based perspective, Reverend Deborah Hart will help participants explore various aspects of grief and help find ways to reinvest in life in meaningful ways. The course will be based on a new video series and materials by Dr. Bill Webster, the Center for Grief Journey, and sponsored by Arbor Memorial. Reverend Hart was with us just a few years ago and has been facilitating grief support programs for over 25 years. There is no cost for this program, although you may wish to donate later to help us make this program available for others in the future. You can register through the church office, 416-447-6846, or at admin@jubileeunited.ca. If you have any questions, please direct them to me, Reverend Norm Seli, at nseli@jubileeunited.ca. Of note as well, our next community table is coming up on Saturday, September the 14th at 6 p.m. No charge, no donations. We just want you to join us for food and friendship. And this month, we're having a mild vegetarian curry on rice with naan bread. And I hear there might be cake and ice cream for dessert. As for pictures, well, the Jubilee Bee Pics are coming in and we are sharing them. A lot of them, you may have noticed. We have an Instagram page, JubileeBee7, that is featuring the adventures of JB. So come on, show us where you and JB are hanging out and what you're doing. This week, we've been to Newfoundland and Casaloma. And it's not just a summer thing. I can't wait to see JB back at school, at work, playing in the leaves as they change. As we smile at the pictures, we can begin to understand how and where God's love shows up. Because we showed up. Or because we really needed to not be alone. But please, don't limit yourself to JB pics. We love all kinds of pictures. They do help make our worship services unique. And let's not forget about limericks. Today we had four, and they were pretty good, if I dare say so myself. So why not join in? Offer an opinion in verse, something about going back to school or coming home for vacation or anything at all. Come on, give it a try. Send us a limerick and let's see what happens. We really do want your five lines of humor or heckle, happiness or hope. Pictures and limericks can all be sent to me at nseli@jubileeunited.ca. And as we celebrate the arrival of the Amayar family to Canada and offer a group for those who are grieving free of charge, you can see that financial support makes it possible for Jubilee to make positive changes in people's lives. Your financial support allows us to pursue God's call to love our neighbors. But it's not just about the money, it's also about being a neighbor. Welcoming people into community in a way that doesn't demand that they conform to some kind of standard, but invites them into a place where their gifts, experiences, and identity are recognized and embraced. It's about loving people and inviting them to love as well. And you do that with your time and your works, with your attention to detail and your unbridled enthusiasm. On Sundays, at community table, at Bible study, or in any of our social or learning events, you make our ministry real. So thank you for your efforts, for your patience, your risk, and your enthusiasm. You make Jubilee a good place to be. A community that is truly supportive and holy. And thank you specifically for your financial support. Your donations through PAR, pre-authorized remittance, check, e-transfer to admin@jubileeunited.ca, through canadahelps.org, or shared in person on Sunday, inspire us all and make it possible for us to be the church that we dream of being, the community that God intends us to be, a home for all of God's children, including you. Thank you for making Jubilee home.